In this video, I'll be reprocessing archives to clear corruption, combine the data from two different archive files, and to split a large archive file into smaller ones. Archive reprocessing is a task performed on offline archives that will take the event data from one or two archive files and rebuild a new archive. This task will recover any recoverable events from corrupted archives, and different options can be passed in order to manipulate the output in specific ways. The first reprocess I'll show you is how to recover events from an archive that we've determined to have corruption. This process will also be necessary if you're backfilling to archives created before PyData Archive 2012 to points that were created after the archive file was. Because you can only reprocess offline archives, the first step is to make sure that your archive is offline. If the archive you're trying to reprocess is primary, the only way to take it offline is to stop the PyArchive subsystem service. If your PyArchive isn't primary, you can choose to unregister it or to stop the PyArchive subsystem. If you're trying to decide between unregistering the archive or stopping the PyArchive subsystem, keep in mind that data sent to an archive gap will be lost. And while stopping the PyArchive subsystem will prevent you from making an archive gap, no users will be able to read PyData while it's down. This is my corrupt archive, and since I won't be backfilling any data to it, we'll reprocess it by unregistering it. I'll then open a command prompt as administrator, and then navigate to the %PyServer% environment variable /bin using the dflag. The program we want to use is piarchss. I'll first pass a question mark to show you that this will display the help dialog with the proper use of the command and then all the options we'll be using below. My first reprocess will be piarchss to call the program and then if. Here we have to provide the file path to the input file. To make sure I don't make any mistakes, the safest way to do this is to navigate to the archive file in Windows Explorer, which is on my D drive in PyArch, and it was timestamped on the 8th at 9:17:01. Before executing any reprocess, it's good practice to create a copy of your archives before you reprocess. So I'll copy this archive onto my backup drive F in case something goes wrong. Back in my D PyArch folder, I'll copy the folder path and then paste it into the command line. And then copy and paste the file name of the archive. The next argument we're going to pass is OF, followed by the file name of the output. Since I want to create a new archive file as the result of this reprocess, I'll manually provide a file path that doesn't exist yet. I'll use a similar file path to the name of my input file, except I'll add an underscore reprocess at the end. As of PyData 2012, or 3.4.390, the archive subsystem will do an integrity check on archive files before reprocessing. A corrupt archive is likely to fail an integrity check, so if you know your input file is corrupt, you need to add noinputcheck to continue the reprocess. Next, I'll add a -F0 to tell piarchss that I want to make a fixed archive and use the same file size as the input file. This archive is a historical archive, so piarchss will use the same historical start time and end time of the input file. But if it was a primary archive, I'd want to include -OT primary to signal that I want the output archive to be a primary archive. Finally, I'll send the resulting messages to a text file on my D drive, called reprocess underscore, and then the file name of my input file. After I hit enter, the archive subsystem will work behind the scenes to reprocess the archive, and in order to check its progress, I'll navigate to the D drive and open the text file I created. Here we can see that piarchss is reprocessing my corrupt file, and since the output file didn't already exist, it's going to be created. And if we scroll down to the bottom of the text file, we can tell that it's not quite done. So let's close Notepad and be patient while it finishes. Once the reprocess is complete, printed at the bottom of the text file will be a complete message, followed by some statistics about the output file. This reprocess was a success, so I'll go back into PiSystem Management Tools to register my archive back into my archive gap. The next reprocess I'll do is reprocess an archive to split an archive file into smaller archives by manipulating the start time and end time of my output, as well as filtering input events by time. This procedure can also be used to change the end time of a particular archive if you're trying to stretch it over an archive gap, or to trim an archive to fit into an archive gap that already exists. This first archive on my PiData archive was made before I configured my automatic archive creation tuning parameters, and it's a little too large for my system. What I'm going to do is break it into two smaller archives that have similar sizes as the rest of my archive file. This file starts at 7:42 and runs until 9:17 the next morning, so I'll separate it by breaking it in half around 2:30 a.m. I'll start by unregistering it, and then making a copy of it on my backup drive again. And back in the command prompt, I can run two different piarchss commands to create two separate output files. The first will be piarchss, then if, and now the file path to the large archive file I just unregistered. So let's go copy and paste the file path, and then the file name again, and I want to make an output file of the same name, because this archive will start at the same time, except for I'll add an underscore split at the end. Now this time, I'll specify an output start time of the 7th of February in 2016 at 1942, which is the start of the large archive file in day, month, year, hour, minute, second format. And I'll specify an output end time of the 8th of February at 2:32. I also want this archive to be fixed at 256 megabytes, like my other archive files. But I don't need to add a no-input check, because this time I want to be warned if this archive isn't healthy. I do, however, want to add a filter underscore X, which is filter exclusive option, to filter out the input events to match my output time. Filter exclusive will cause the reprocess to ignore any events that occur outside this time range, but also ignore any events that fall on the exact end time of this time range. I'm doing this because the next archive will start on this archive's end time, and I don't want any events to appear in my archive files twice. If your PiData archive is older than 2010, you won't have access to this command, and the best way to handle events that occur on an archive boundary in that case is to end your earlier archive 1 millisecond before the next one starts. I'll send the output file to a different text file and then run the command. And in order to check its progress, I'll navigate to the D drive and open the text file I created. You get this warning message if you use an OSI with a filter or filter X command, and it's just to let you know about the problem I described about double archive events on archive boundaries. Since we're aware of this, this is nothing to worry about, so we'll come back in 30 seconds to look at our output file. Here we can see that the reprocess has started, and we're going to create a new output file. Scrolling to the bottom of the message log, we can see it's not quite done, so let's come back once it's completed. After waiting a while, scrolling to the bottom of my text file, I see a success message with my output archive statistics. Now, back in the command prompt, I want to create the second half of my archive split. So I'll input the same archive file, but this time I'll make an archive that starts on the halfway mark of my large input archive. And ends when my large archive originally ended. And filter out anything that's outside the last half of my large archive. I'm using filter instead of filter exclusive this time because I want to include any event that might happen to be on the exact time of this archive. I'll make it a fixed archive again at 256 megabytes. And then we'll continue our procedure of sending the output to a text file, running the command, and then opening Notepad to verify that it started successfully. Here it looks like it understood the input file and is going to create a new output file. So let's close Notepad and wait for it to complete. Once it completes, I'll check for a success message one more time, and after I confirm that it is successful, I know that I can go back into System Management Tools and register my two split archives to fill the space that my large archive used to occupy. And here we can see the result of turning one large archive into two smaller ones. The last task I'll be using reprocessing for is to merge data from our recovered interface buffer into my current archives. Back on my D drive, I'll show you that I have an archive file that I have from reprocessing a corrupted buffer file a few days ago, and it needs to get merged into my already existing PI data. But I'm not sure exactly what time period this data covers. So back in the command prompt, I can go back a folder into the piadm directory. Now here I can run pidiag ahd to dump the header of any archive file. And if I target my dbuf_reprocessarc file, I can see that this file covers between 9.12.12 and 1504.43 on the 9th of February in 2016. This means that back in PI System Management Tools, the reprocessed archive file starts about halfway through this archive and goes a few hours into this archive. So I'll take note of their start and end time, and then unregister them so I can merge my reprocessed buffer data. Before I go back into my command prompt, I'll visit the PyArk folder again to make a copy of these files onto my backup drive. Going to my command prompt, and not forgetting to return to my PyBin directory, I'll reprocess the reprocessed buffer file by typing if, and then typing out the folder that it's in, and then hitting the tab key to automatically cycle through all the files in this folder until my reprocessed archive file path shows up. My output file will be the first archive file in the list, so let's go copy and paste that file path and that file name into the command prompt. I'll specify that I want the output file to start at the same time and end at the same time as my first archive file. As well as filtering out any input events that don't also fall within that time. I'll choose to use filter exclusive here to make sure that I don't duplicate any events that might be in the archive boundary. Again, I'll send reprocess messages to a text file, and then hitting enter, I'll go see that the reprocess has started without errors. Once we see that the reprocess is in progress, we can wait patiently until it finishes. After that reprocess completes and the text file reports a success, I'll reprocess the same file into my other archive file, specifying its different start time and end time, as well as filtering out inputs that don't fall within that time period. I'm using filter instead of filter exclusive this time because I want to include any event that might happen to be on the exact end time of this archive. I'll repeat the same process of sending the output to a text file and checking the text file to make sure that the reprocess starts successfully. After being patient again, opening the text file and scrolling to the bottom, we can confirm that this reprocess was also a success. Now back in PiSystem Management Tools, I can register those files again with the new events that were recovered from the buffer queue. Archive reprocessing is an advanced skill for PiAdmins, and it's important to understand the implications and results and to do it properly. Luckily, we have lots of resources and examples on the topic. KB159 is an overview of the piarchss utility. KB2367 will step you through recovering from corruption. 590 shows you how to split archives. KB3108 will show you how to merge archives. And KB713 has a series of other examples that you can use as references.